The cosmic factor between the years 1952 and 56, Anno Domini. A combination of celestial forces collided with the spiritual powers of nature to bring forth tradition.
Hi everyone, welcome to another video. So this is going to be the next instalment of recent spins. So I've been trying to do this on a monthly basis and didn't quite manage to make it at the end of March, end of April. Really starting to lose track now. So we're well into May now and this is the recent spins for April. We got there in the end, didn't we? The eagle-eyed amongst you will have noticed that I've now uploaded a vinyl finds video, and there's another vinyl finds video coming down the tracks, and finding what's happening now, of course, is that I'm spending more time again listening to new collection editions rather than doing this, which is digging around on the shelves, finding things I haven't listened to for a long time. I'm going to try and keep this series up for as long as I can, okay? So let me show you what I've been copying an earful to. So this is Can and their album Monster Movie. Might have been their debut album, they were called The Can. This is when they still had the inimitable vocalist Malcolm Mooney in the band. I dug this out, just want to give another shout out to John Baggy Hi-Fi, who did a marvellous two-part video on spiritual music, and he and his friends showed lots and lots of very interesting things. Everything from Penderecki through to the Grateful Dead via Can, and you know, all kinds of things. Fantastic video, two parts, and that inspired me to dig this out. This is a reissue. The problem with listening to Can, they tend to throw everything into shadow. After you've listened to a Can record, there's not much point listening to anything else because they're so kind of just questing and voyaging and just pushing boundaries all the time. Anything you listen to after that tends to sound very safe and conservative. Yeah, just fantastic music. They've got this incredible way of just sounding as if they're constantly, or occasionally rather, trying to just blast a hole in the fabric of time and space and just plunge through to the other side. You just get these kind of crescendos which come out of nowhere, and they seem to just take you through this little wormhole into a new sonic environment. It's just absolutely amazing what they did. And Jackie Leibezit is just so stunning, just his rhythmic control, his sound. God knows how he managed to make his drums sound like that. But anyway, yeah, just a fantastic revisit. And I need to get some more Can into the collection. Next to impossible to find their original albums, obviously. So, you know, you're looking at reissues. But yeah, thanks, John, for reminding me of that record. And please do check out John's video, Baggy Hi-Fi. Now this next one, I saw Doug at Fat City Vinyl showing this, so that led me to seek it out. This is Kamasi Washington's album, Harmony of Difference, just trying to work out which is the front and which is the back. So this is a bit of a VC staple. Kamasi Washington is a bit of a VC staple. He did that vast album, triple album called The Epic. Back in whenever it was, a fair few years ago now. Just to recap, he's an American jazz composer. I didn't get that record, it was rather expensive, and I found the idea of it rather forbidding, you know, this vast, I think it was three discs? I will get it at some point, but he made this album, this one came out subsequently, and it's quite a short album, so I thought I would dip my toe into his music to see if I enjoyed it, and I did. It's extremely accomplished composed jazz album. The closest thing that I can think of, you know, from the old school would be Charles Mingus, maybe. On this particular record, he does lots of variations on a theme, so the same tune keeps coming back in different guises. It's very orchestrated. It's very euphoric, a little bit elegiac. It's got a great kind of stirring passion to it. And yeah, just a really great album, and I may well end up getting the Epic, I don't know, but that was a nice way of dipping my toe into Kamasi Washington. I bought this a few years ago now, and but, you know, I hadn't listened to it for a while, so thanks to Doug, Fat City Vinyl, for that reminder. Right, this next one was a gift, actually, a couple of years ago now, from Headley, another fat bearded man talking about records. I hadn't listened to it for a while, so thought I would put that right. And this is Garden Party by Rick Nielsen. This came out in 1972. So Rick Nielsen, obviously, kind of, you know, 60s pop idol, bit of a golden boy of you know, rock and roll and just great seminal pop music. But in the 1970s, well, I'm not going to pretend I know anything about his career, to be honest with you, but just by the evidence of this record, he went in a more kind of rocky direction, really. Quite, I don't know, quite bluesy, quite hard driving at times. And this record's got a real mixture of stuff on it. There's tracks which sound almost glammy. They've got a bit of a kind of glam stomp to them. And there's a cover on here of I'm Talking About You by Chuck Berry, which sounds for all the world like a song. It sounds like something from Ace Frehley's solo album, you know, from 1978 or whatever it was. Not really what you'd expect Rick Nielsen to do. It's got a kind of well, I suppose broadly speaking, it would fall into the category of country rock. But it's a fairly diverse listen. Good record, not one that I would have maybe pulled out myself. So thanks again, Headley, for alerting me to that one. Right, these next two are charity shop finds from years ago. You know, you get these kind of records that you bought in a charity shop years ago, and maybe you did listen to them a lot, but you haven't listened to them for so long. And this one, I used to love this. This may well have been my first ever jazz vocal album. Might even have been my first jazz album. Bought it from, I think it was from the Oxfam shop in Headingley. Would have been back in the 90s. This is Genius Hits the Road by Ray Charles. And this is still one of the greatest sounding records in my collection. It's all standards, you know, he does things like Georgia on My Mind, Basin Street Blues, California, Here I Come, Moonlight in Vermont, but just the sound on the record, the sound of his voice, just the orchestrations, beautifully recorded. I mean, God knows how old this record is, but it sounds fantastic. So I pulled it out and then I just kept listening to it then, you know, because just wonderful stuff. Ray Charles, Genius Hits the Road. And then this one again, had it in my collection for years, and he's an artist that doesn't get enough of a look in, really, on the VC. I mean, you could say the same thing for Ray Charles, but this guy, Sam Cooke, he tends to be overshadowed by people like Otis Redding and, you know, whatever, Sam and Dave. I think it's because, well, a bit like Ray Charles, I guess, he was so seminal, he kind of wrote the rule book, really, and then everybody else copied him, and he kind of got a bit forgotten. But, you know, back in his day, he was such a seminal force, very versatile. And I guess because his repertoire took in, you know, pop songs and standards and, you know, slightly jazzier things, more commercial things, maybe he didn't get the reputation that people like Otis Redding got later on as being very kind of, you know, gut bucket soul. But he had such a wonderful, ethereal, beautiful, delicate voice. And this record's got some stunning material on it. It's got a song called They Call the Wind Maria on it, which, if anybody else sang it, it would just be a cornball pop song, but he just turns it into something absolutely divine. There's a great version of Duke Ellington's Don't Get Around Much Anymore, which you might do a bit of a needle drop on. But always a pleasure to revisit Sam Cooke, and something that I should do more often, really. As should other people. Next one, we've got a bit of British reggae. So this is Steel Pulse and Tribute to the Martyrs. This was their second album. It's not their most famous album. The most famous one is the debut. But this is still a good listen. So they were a very politically motivated, you know, politically driven British reggae band from the Birmingham area of the UK. And, you know, they did lots of stuff, kind of, you know, anti-racist kind of stuff in the late 70s. And just a kind of classic British reggae sound. Nice album. I don't think it's necessarily top drawer all the way through. Side 2's got a couple of rather forgettable cuts on it, I thought. But Side 1's got some great stuff on it. Joe Pickney, RAR is a good track. And actually on Side 2, Babylon Makes the Wheels is good too. So yeah, I picked this up maybe, would have been last year or perhaps even the year before, I don't know. Happy Birthday Bams, it says on the back. It says to Glyn, lots of love, Denise, and then it says Happy Birthday Babs, so not quite sure what's going on with that, but anyway, it was nice to disinter that one from the shelves. What's playing? So you'd have seen this in the introduction. This is Captain Ganja and the Space Patrol by the British dub reggae band Tradition. Now, this record came, I think it came out in maybe 1979, something like that. What's the guy's name from the band? Paul Thompson. And my understanding is that he kind of introduced synths into reggae and started messing around with, you know, drum machines and primitive samples. Introduced synths into dub music in order to give it a slightly spectral, almost a surreal kind of edge. Really interesting record and incredibly ahead of its time, actually. If you listen to the kind of sound and the mood, you know, you just think of stuff from the mid 80s, late 80s, early 90s. I did read somewhere that it was a big influence on The Orb and Alex Paterson, and you can really hear that. This was a reissue which came out a few years back. If you want to buy an original copy of it, you're looking at hundreds of pounds, you know. I think it might be classed as an EP, but it's seems to play like an LP. It seems like LP length, and it plays at 33, but yeah, great stuff. Tradition. Captain Ganja and the Space Patrol. And right now, this next one is actually quite a recent purchase. I was going to show it in the next Vinyl Finds video, but the next Vinyl Finds video has a particular theme to it, and this album does not fit into the theme, so I thought, why not show it now? Strictly speaking, this is a spin from the last week or so, you know, but I'm gonna cheat slightly. Now, this came from watching Chris at the Vinyl Orchard, and he's been buying a lot of fusion records of late. He's getting really into it, as I have been too. I mean, Chris is way ahead of me. He's buying stuff at a race of knots, you know. I find these fusion records not that often, but I'm starting to pick them up as and when I do. So this is Passport and the album Cross Collateral. And they were a German band around in the early 1970s, I think. The guy from the group, the main chap from the group, is called Klaus Doldinger. So there's a bit of it, almost sounds like a sort of Tangerine Dream-esque kind of name, doesn't it? And they had quite a few albums, I think. This one came from 1975. And Chris was saying in his video, it's extremely enjoyable. It's probably more, you know, with fusion, you get like rock fusion. Is it jazz with a bit of rock? Is it rock with a bit of jazz? Is it funk with a bit of rock or funk jazz, whatever, you know? This sounds, I think Chris said this sounds like it's got more of an emphasis on the kind of rock funk side with a bit of jazz thrown in. So you don't get the very, very, very pyrotechnical, you know, extremely technical stuff that you might get with, say, you know, Chick Corea or Weather Report Mahavishnu. What you get is something funkier, probably closer to something like Herbie Hancock. Really, really good stuff. It's got real groove to it, real kind of, I don't know, it's just, it pulls along, shall we say, you know, it's powerful stuff. It's got synths, it's got saxes, and yeah, there's a bit of a gut bucket feel to it at times. Really, really good, excellent. So thanks to Chris for alerting me to these guys. Got this from the local antiques place, so tremendous. Passport. We'll be right back. Two more to go. Now this was some VCLT as well, a while back, from Martin Parrott, now known as the Vinyl Scavenger, here on YouTube. And he and I are going to do a video at some point, hopefully in the not too distant future, on this band. So I thought I would dig it out again. This is Starfish by The Church. Not a group that I ever encountered back in the day. I mean, they sort of didn't have much of a commercial prospect, shall we say, in the UK. So perhaps it's understandable that I missed out on them. But yeah, really good kind of melancholy Australian rock. Nice lyrical songs. It's a bit of a VC staple, really. So thanks to Martin for that one. Nice to hear it again. And finally, it's kind of turning into a bit of a theme with these videos. I've been ending each of these Vinyl Spins video with a Jethro Tull record, because I'm working my way through the collection. The six records that Steve Carlson was kind enough to send me a couple of years back. So this is the next one, and this is Songs from the Wood, which comes from 1977, maybe? It's kind of late 1970s. And this is poppier than some of the ones that I've shown so far. I've shown Minstrel from the Gallery and Thick as a Brick so far, which are more kind of elongated structures, shall we say. This one is more, it's kind of short songs, but it's possibly the most medieval sounding one. It's just, there's so many songs that conjure images of just, you know, gambling, fair maidens, and, you know, hunts through the woods and everything. In fact, there's even a song on the record called Hunting Girl. And you've got tracks like Velvet Green and The Whistler and Jack in the Green. It's all very kind of, you know, medieval pageantry. You can imagine just a kind of medieval scene with, you know, jesters and oxes roasting on the spit and all the rest of it. Really, really nice album, actually. It's, like I said, it's quite poppy. It's quite upbeat. Just need to change the record. A couple of videos ago, I made a remark saying something like, I'm trying to orientate myself with regards to Jethro Tull, trying to work out what it is about them that makes them them. And I've come to the conclusion that there's two things that define Jethro Tull, not define Jethro Tull, but characterise Jethro Tull. First of all, they're very upbeat, they're very sunny group. They don't seem to have many kind of dark corners or any real kind of lurking psychological menace to them, you know. Everything's very sunny, everything's very nice. And that's great, nothing wrong with that at all. And also, it's the rhythmical aspect that I'm starting to key into now. Most of their songs have this kind of rolling, gambling kind of feel to them. They do go into these progressive, fiddly bits, like all these progressive rock bands like to do, but something about Jethro Tull is there's more of a forward driving thing going on. It's like this constant, almost like a galloping, gambling across the fields kind of feel. And when you start to tap into it, it does start to get quite addictive. You know, you get into their groove, shall we say. And this is a very enjoyable record. I particularly like the final song, Fire at Midnight, which sounds to me like a song about Ian Anderson getting home from a very long tour, lighting a fire in his back garden, and then going into his house in order to go to bed with his wife. You know, really nice, sweet song. So there we go, next instalment in my Tull explorations. And hopefully there'll be another one in the next instalment. So the next vinyl update I do will be vinyl finds again. And I've got some great finds all lined up, so look out for that. I hope you're all well, and I'll see you soon. Bye.
Miss the Saturday dance. I heard they crowded the floor. Couldn't bear it without you. I don't get around much anymore. Thought I'd visit the club. Got as far as the door. They'd have asked me about you. I don't get around much anymore. And oh, darling, I guess my mind's more at ease, but nevertheless, why stir up old memories? Been invited on dates, might have gone, but what for? Awfully different without you. I don't get around much. much anymore.